Good morning. Let's stand and worship our Heavenly Father in song.
I'm so glad you made me. seated for a minute. Thank you so much for coming to Kingsland Baptist Church this morning. Happy Father's Day. Hopefully you guys knew it was Father's Day. If not, you better run to Walmart or something right after this service and get your father a card. My father was in town this week. I got to spend some time with him. Hopefully you'll take some time to honor your fathers this morning also. If you are a father today, we would like to honor you, and we have some gifts back in the foyer. Be sure to grab one of those on the way out. Also, this Wednesday night, we are starting Heroes, which is going to be a great Wednesday night Bible study on the different heroes in the Bible. The children are going to be studying Heroes. The students are going to be studying Heroes. The adults are going to be studying Heroes. We're having a kickoff this Wednesday night here in the auditorium. Everyone's meeting together to start with, so be here at 6:30 Wednesday night. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you that we can come to your house and that we can worship you today. I pray that you would help us to worship you with the way that we live, the way that we respond to the songs and to your message today. In your name I pray. Amen.
Let's stand and continue to worship.
Thank you. He's going to pray for our offering this morning. I hope that you will give the Lord all of your worship, all of your praise, with your resources, with your finances, with your song, with every part of you. And as we come to our time of giving, thank you for being here. Thank you for being cheerful givers. We have a giving-hearted and a giving-minded church, and I praise the Lord for that.
Father, we come this morning just amazed and at the many blessings that you give us, and for being such a loving and awesome God, that a God that loves us regardless of our many faults and shortcomings, asking only that we accept the salvation that he offers so freely to each and every one of us. I ask now, Lord, you bless this offering we'll receive as we return a small portion of what you have given to us, we give back to you. Bless this church, Lord, as you have for the past 100-plus years. And bless our pastor, Lord, as he brings us the message. And I ask a special blessing upon our fathers this day. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
And that he paid the price a long, long time ago, when he gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want to know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. Just can't bear of hurting him. It seems that I'm so good at breaking promises, and that I treat his precious grace so carelessly. But each time he hurting.
He is holy. So holy. I thank you, Janet, for singing. I love to hear her sing. And that's a beautiful song. Thank you, each and every one, for being here today, especially you dads. All of our men, pick up your little gift on the way out. And there's a verse that accompanies this eagle from Isaiah 40:31. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. So pick that up and let that be a reminder to you of what you should be doing. And I know there is no daddy in this room any prouder than Bob Schwab. And his son and his whole family, beautiful family, is here today. But his son, Sean, just finished boot camp at Parris Island. And we want to recognize you this morning. Sean Schwab, PFC Schwab, would you please stand? We're so proud of you. Great to have you home, and we are praying for you. We're praying for all of our military folks. And Father's Day is special. I know this is probably one you'll never forget, Bob. And I got an early Father's Day present. My little boy David, my 1.5-year-old, took a flashlight and clocked me in the face with it yesterday. And my lip bled the whole day. It just wouldn't stop bleeding. And it was horrible. It was terrible, but it hurt. Oh, man, did that hurt. But that's just his way of saying, I love you. And my wife is very compassionate. She said, well, what in the world did you put to your face? I was like, he hit me with a flashlight. I had no idea it was coming. But I hope you're enjoying a wonderful Father's Day. And what a special time. We, you know, not everybody's a daddy, but everybody's got a daddy. And we fathers have the unbelievably difficult job of being a human representation, a very flawed attempt, a picture to our children and to the world that there is a heavenly Father who loves us all unconditionally. And little boy looked up to his daddy and said, Daddy, what makes an elephant so big? And of course, all of his dads have been there. I don't know what makes an elephant so big. And he said, well, what makes a lion so dangerous? Why are lions so dangerous? And son, I really don't know why that is. And Daddy, why do birds fly? How do they do that? And, you know, other than wings, son, I don't know what makes birds fly. And the little boy looked up and said, Daddy, am I bothering you with all my questions? And Daddy responded, of course not, son. You'll never learn anything if you don't ask questions. But, you know, it's hard being a dad. It's hard being the one who's supposed to have all the answers. And, this summer there is a blockbuster movie that is, you know, Iron Man. Have you heard about that movie, Iron Man? Well, you know, most dads feel like they need to be Iron Man and you know, bulletproof and can fly and shoot missiles. And, of course, if you have little, you know, your children expect you to be Iron Man. And the little ones might even think you are. But we know that we're not. I titled my message this morning, Super Dad. And I feel that way. I feel like, man, if I could just have a blue suit underneath all this with a big S on it, with a cape, first of all, my kids would love that. And I wish I were Super Dad. I wish I were Iron Man. Truth is, I'm not. And I guess it's not realistic or even possible to be Super Dad. But isn't it possible, isn't it realistic to be a Super Daddy? Isn't that what the expectation really is? Isn't that something we can do? You know, what we need now more than anything else, is godly men. And you can fill in the blank after that. We need godly men at home. We need godly men in this church, in our community, in our society. What we need more than anything else is for men to stand up, to stand in the gap, to do and to be what God created us to be. Steve Farrar in his book, Point Man. I hope you got your copy at the men's table at our gifts fair. John Mattering gave a copy out to anybody who wanted one. I saw some women walking around with this thing, Point Man, which I know when their husband gets home, they're going to hear an earful of this. But I love what Steve Farrar had to say. I wish it weren't true, but I agree with him. And when he says, it's my conclusion that effective male leadership in the homes of America is going the way of the dinosaur. Do y'all remember Steve Farrar? He spoke at our men's conference last fall, and I think he's speaking at the one this fall. that we'll go to. Some people are worried about the extinction of whales and condors and snail darters. I never even heard of a snail darter. Baby seals. Those are legitimate concerns. But let me shoot straight with you. I am a lot more worried about the extinction of the men who know the extinction of men who know how to lead a family. And the effective male leader who knows how to lead his family is already on the endangered species list. Man, I wish he was wrong. Dr. Dobson, James Dobson from Focus on the Family, wrote this 28 years ago. The Western world stands at a great crossroads in its history. It is my opinion that our very survival as a people will depend upon the presence or absence of masculine leadership in millions of homes. I believe with everything within me that husbands hold the key to the preservation of the family. And then, of course, you can extrapolate that to society. What we need more than anything is godly men to stand up, to be what God called us to be, to do what God called us to do. Look over to the book of Titus with me. Turn over to the book of Titus, and we're going to read these scriptures, and I'm going to say a prayer today. And if you've got a daddy anywhere within reach of you, grab his arm and pray for him when we pray in just a minute. This is the expectation. This is what the Lord, through the Apostle Paul, writing to Titus, his son in the faith, here is the standard. As we read this, feel free to measure yourself up to the standard. And then we'll pray. Because that's really the only hope we have of being good dads, of being good men, of being the people that God called us to be. In this passage we're going to read, we're not going to be able to study every verse of it. We're going to study the verses that have to do with men. But we'll read through the verses that have to do with men and women. So we all get a little dose of what the Lord has to say. As the Word of God just so sharp, just pierces us. Let it pierce your heart right now. Are you there? Titus chapter 2, verse 1. But as for you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine. That the older men be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love, in patience. Folks, that's a high, high order that we've been given. Verse 3 says, the older men, women likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste. I mean, this just flies in the face of popular opinion of what our culture has turned into. You're not going to see this in Us Weekly, The Inquirer, or anywhere else as you're going through the grocery stand. It's not there. It doesn't exist. It exists here, thank God. And I love this next one. Homemakers. I think the old King James says, keepers at home. Does that sound familiar to you? Yeah, we have a whole ministry for our fifth and sixth grade girls on Wednesday nights during the school year called Keepers at Home. They just wrapped up. Had their award tonight the other night. Good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be blasphemed. Likewise, in verse 6, picks up back on the guys, the younger guys. Likewise, exhort the young men to be sober-minded in all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works, in doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, and incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. Would you pray with me? God in heaven, you've given us your standard. You've given us the mandate. And boy, do we fall short. Lord, I pray that you'd forgive us. Forgive our land for how far America has turned its back on you. Please forgive us. Please bring us back. Please bring a revival. But Lord, I wish it was just outside these walls. But the truth is the church is failing in this area. Lord, we repent of that. And we're going to identify it today, Lord. And we're going to be honest about it. And right now, we just open our hearts up to you and say, Lord, help us to be these things. Help us to do what you've called us to do. Help us to be the men and the women of God that you've called us to be. Lord, I pray for every man in this room that you would bless him. I pray that you'd give our men good health and wisdom and joy and help them to lead the way you've called them to lead. Help them to live the way you've called them to live. Lord, I pray for every daddy and under the sound of my voice, Lord, I pray that you'd help each one of us to embrace this charge that we've been given, this mandate to stand up, to be accounted for, to live lives of holiness and purity, and to be examples for those around us. Lord, I pray that you would just uplift the one who's discouraged today, that you would give some peace to the one who's heartbroken today, comfort to the one who's grieving. Lord, I pray that you administer through the power of the Holy Spirit in ways that no human could ever do, that you would reach down and do something very, very powerful. Lord, extraordinary. Do something extraordinary in our lives today through the preaching of your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, if what we need more than anything else is godly men, what does that mean? Well, I believe the passage answers that question. And I believe that men of all ages, young and old, doesn't matter. Women, you need to hear this. Whatever your background is, you need to be aware of this. Whether you're single or married, whether you have kids or not, this is appropriate for each and every one of us today. Boy, do our children need us right now. And I think they need a whole lot better than what they're getting in so many homes. During an awful thunderstorm, the lightning was cracking and the thunder was rolling, and they had put the kids, mom and dad had put the children to sleep, but daddy's little girl cried out, "Daddy, Daddy, come up, you know, help me, I'm scared." And he ran up the stairs and he knelt by the bed and he prayed with his little girl and he talked to her and said, "Hey, don't worry." We've all said it, right? God's with you. God's here with you. He'll take care of you. And the little girl said, "I know, Daddy, but right now I just need someone with skin on." We, as fathers, dads, have a heavy responsibility. See, it's dad's role to demonstrate the love of God, the Father, with skin on. But the rewards, oh, the rewards, awesome. The rewards are spectacular. I've just received a reward. I'm not going to read it to you because it's personal. But I just received a letter from my son. I think he spelled most of it right, too. I'm going to hold on to this till my dying day. I mean, isn't it true that the rewards are outstanding? They're exceptional. Are you broke? Sure, you're broke. Are you tired? Sure, you're tired. Is it a heavy load? Yeah, it's a heavy load, but it's worth it. It's worth it. And each one of us who are fathers need to be reminded about what we're going to study today. Each one of us that are not fathers, you may be young, old, whatever, female. You need to encourage this in the men around you. This should be the expectation that we're having for every godly man that we know. You see, just came back this week from Indianapolis, the Southern Baptist Convention. Man, did we have a good time at the Southern Baptist Convention in Indianapolis, Indiana. Don't be fooled. Indiana isn't as horrible as you might think. Indianapolis was a lot of fun. We had a good time. And boy, the preaching was unbelievable. The music was awesome. The meetings were great. And in case you haven't heard or read the paper or checked the internet, the Southern Baptist Convention has elected a new president by the name of Johnny Hunt, pastor of First Baptist Church, Woodstock, Georgia. This is a fantastic church, a soul-winning church, a missions-minded church, a real neat guy. And he'll serve for the next couple years, assuming he gets elected next year, which he will, as the president of the Southern Baptist Convention. And I'm proud to tell you, proud and I get humbled to tell you, man, the state of your convention, yeah, there's room for improvement, but boy, this is a great fellowship. 45,000+ churches that stand on the Word of God as being inerrant, infallible. That's pretty cool. 45,000 churches that should be preaching the Word of God, and they are. Some are doing it more effectively than others. We are one of thousands of churches that are standing for the truth. And man, was it exciting to be in that company. But even listening to, you know, Richard Land. Are you familiar with Richard Land with the Ethics and Faith and Ethics Committee of the Southern Baptist Convention? Boy, he just couldn't have said it more plainly. And I think he was actually having a discussion with Ergen Kanner from Liberty University. And we are in trouble as a nation. The God of Islam is not the God of the Bible. Now, that may be very offensive to somebody, but you need to know that. Allah and Jehovah are two very different things, two very different entities. And, of course, there's 1,000 other things I could report on, but I walked away from there just thinking, man, do we need men to stand up? Men of God, men of courage, men of faith to stand up the only hope for the Southern Baptists, the only hope for the world, for our nation, is for people of faith to stand up. And I believe that they will follow godly men, men of integrity. See, that's the problem. We've seen so many people fall. We've seen so many people that we lifted up and were propped up in front of us that have fallen. So people aren't trusting as much. People are more cynical, aren't we? When we look at Titus chapter 2, we see the values, the qualities of this godly man. This is what we should be fixated on. I can tell you, on a regular basis, I pray this prayer. Dear God, oh Lord, help me to be a godly person, a godly partner, a godly parent, and a godly pastor. Four things. And if we made that our prayer, and if we lived it out, and you say, well, I'm not a pastor. Well, you're shepherding something. Someone's following you. You may not be a parent yet. That's okay. You may not have your partner yet. That's all right. Pray for one. When we see these qualities, this is what it's all about. We go, oh, be good, do right. This is the nuts and bolts of what it is to be a godly man. So let's study it. A godly man, number one. If you have your bulletins, just fill them out. You have blanks right there on the back. You can fill this out as you go. A godly man is sensible. He is sensible. He thinks carefully. He's a thinker. He thinks before he acts. He thinks before he speaks. Look at verse 2, very beginning, that the older men be sober. And then the younger men get it in verse 6, that the younger men be sober-minded. It's saying the same thing. Be of sound mind. Be reasonable. My daddy always said, son, use your head. Think. The Expositor Bible Commentary says this about verse 6. Since young men are inclined to be somewhat impetuous and unrestrained in conduct, their basic need is to be self-controlled, cultivating balance and a self-restraint in daily practice. And that's true, isn't it? The stereotype of the young man, wild, sowing wild oats. Man, don't let that be you. You need to break that stereotype. We are to be thoughtful. We are to think, to be smart. I love that old saying, measure twice, cut once. You remember that? Measure twice, cut once. Because once you cut, man, it's cut. Think. Be sensible. Use common sense. You know, Tim Russert was a thinker. Tim Russert was a sensible man. Do you remember Tim Russert? He passed away on Friday at the age of 58. Very sad story. Probably one of the strongest, biggest names in politics. And whether it's people that lean to the left or lean to the right, Democrats, Republicans, liberal, conservative, everybody had something good to say about Tim Russert. Because he was a thinker. He was articulate. And he could talk to anybody. And both sides of the aisle agree. Even President Bush said, I mean, Tim Russert, what a wonderful, wonderful man. And my question to you is this. What are they going to say about you when you're gone? Now, most of us aren't on MSNBC. Most of us aren't celebrities. But what are the people around you going to say? Are they going to have to think about something nice to say about you because you're dead and gone and they've got to say something? Are they going to be able to say, man, that guy's life made an impact. He was different. He was sensible. He was, number two, reverent. A godly man is reverent. He behaves respectfully. Look down at verse 2. It says that, be reverent. If you have the NIV, I think it says be dignified. Be respectable and be respectful. You're not going to give respect unless you give respect. And the reverent man understands that. He understands there's a time for fun and games. But there's also a time to be very, very serious. Very serious. Pop culture makes a mockery of this, folks. Our current culture makes a mockery of reverence. Anything irreverent, ha, 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 that's so funny. As blasphemous and disgusting as they can be, that's what's funny. And anybody that actually toes the line, that actually has a reverent bone in his or her body, is a joke in our culture. But let's not forget Proverbs 14:9 that says, fools mock at sin, but among the upright there is favor. If you want to have favor with God or favor with man, if you want to have favor with God, it means you're going to be reverent. Now, I am not talking about physical or outward reverence, although it can display. There are irreverent things, gestures and so forth. But what I'm really talking about is an attitude of your heart. It's a mindset. It's a mentality that I am a God-fearing person. I am reverent. I'm not talking about your attire. I'm not talking about decorations. I'm talking about having a godly reverence, a fear of God, an awe of who He is. You know, when you handle a handgun, if you're smart, any adult that's teaching a child to handle, a young person to handle a handgun, is going to say, now you need to be very respectful of what you're holding. This is a weapon. This is powerful. This could take somebody's life. Well, the reverent person approaches life that way. He understands that the self-esteem of a child is a very sensitive thing. The feelings of a wife, the spiritual destination of other folks, this church, is to be handled reverently. A godly man, a godly person is sensible, is reverent. Number three, a godly person is temperate. He responds moderately. This is talking about moderation. Do you see it right there in verse number two? Be temperate or be self-controlled. Remember the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I might have said one twice. Anyway, self-control, fruit of the Spirit. We need it. I need it. You need it. And men, again, back to the young man. What's the model young, you know, the James Dean, the wild rebel, you know, just blows his top and blowing off some steam. And all. No, that doesn't need to be you. Of course, this is actually addressed to the older men. It's interesting to me that he tells the older men to be sensible, to be reverent, to be self-controlled. Shouldn't they have it by now? Well, you older men, tell me, do you have it by now? I hope I do when I'm your age. You know, there were certain Christian leaders last year at the Southern Baptist Convention when we met in San Antonio that weren't in Indianapolis this year. And the reason is because they had no self-control. You see, you only have to blow it once to ruin everything. And I'm thinking of local leaders. I'm thinking of national leaders. It's a never-ending line, it seems like, of supposedly holy men, you know, that don't have this. Do you realize one careless moment can cost you your marriage? Do you realize that none of us are above temptation? Not you, not me. So let's not be so pious. Let's be honest about it. We need self-control. One thoughtless word or action could destroy your family, could destroy your relationship with your kids. Be careful. Be self-controlled. And we live in a society that is fixated on instant gratification. That's what it's all about. How can I have what I want right now? Get out the credit card, swipe it, boom, it's mine. Get you a big loan and buy a house you can't afford. And then blame it on the government when you lose it. That kind of thing. We want it right now. Hey, I'm 19 years old. I deserve a three-story house right now. And everything I want at my fingertips. That's the society we live in. Instant gratification. If it feels good, do it. If you're tired of that one, just leave her and go to another one. That's the society we live in. And because of that, we need to be very intentional about displaying self-control. Don't expect it to happen naturally. Don't expect it to happen accidentally. You need to think through it. It goes back to being sensible. Think through it. And just real life application here, folks. We need to show moderation in our habits, in our eating, in our entertainment choices, movies, music, whatever, television. Show moderation in your hobbies. Do you have balance in your life? We talked about balance last week. Remember rowing the boat? Do you have balance between your work life, your family life? Even your church life can get out of balance. It's possible to spend too much time at church. Can you believe I said that? It's true. Are you neglecting your family for something else? Be self-controlled. Be careful. Number four, the godly man is sound. He is sound. He serves dependably. His life is characterized by dependability, consistency, faithfulness. You see that in verse 2? Be sound. This person is a solid rock that you can depend on. He's like Old Faithful out in Wyoming at the Yellowstone National Park. Man, they can depend on that thing. I think it's every 90 minutes or something. Boom, it's going to go off. Of course, some men are very dependable. Boom, they're going to go off. You know, that's not what I'm talking about. They're dependable. They're consistent. You can rely on this person. Be sound. You see it? Look at verse 2. Be sound in faith, in love, and in patience. That's perseverance, endurance. Be sound. You know, the best gift any dad can give, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, and I hope you'll hear it because I mean it. I believe this with all my heart. The best gift any dad can give his family, the best gift any dad can give his children is not some sort of physical present. Here it is. Love your wife, take care of your wife, and offer a consistent, secure, dependable environment for children to grow up in and understand in their minds, it may not ever even be said, there is no get out of jail free card, there is no divorce, there is no exceptions to the rule, this is how it's going to be, this family will be together for life, permanent, permanency. And very few kids have that. Do you realize that? Very few kids have that. Consistency. Solid. Yeah, I have a kitchen table. The kitchen table we ate on this morning in my home, I ate on when I was 5 years old. I've had it my whole life. It was really beat up back then. So as a married wedding present, my parents got it all varnished and fixed up and glossed up and gave it to us as a wedding present 10 years ago. And I think my wife's probably tired of it by now. But anyway, I love my table. And the reason is it's solid. I like a solid table. Have you ever had a wobbly table, you know, like a restaurant? I hate wobbly tables. I would rather not eat. I would rather eat on the ground if it's solid. And the funniest part about it is my father and mother gave us that because my mother's mother, who is now 91, moved in with them and brought her antique table that is as wobbly as it gets. And my father hates it. Every time he eats at my table, he feels it. And he goes, oh, I love this table. I miss this table. Nobody likes to eat on a wobbly table. And no kid should have to grow up in a wobbly, unstable, insecure environment. And it's your job, Dad, to make that happen. Husbands, love your wives. Period. Unconditional. That's the end of it. Be sound. Be dependable. We need strong, sound men to shape the next generation of young men in our church. And they need an example. They need to be able to see it. So let's move into the young men. The last three are for the young men. Number five, we see in verse 7, a godly man is holy. He lives righteously. The godly man is holy. And that's such a big word. Oh, holy. Well, none of us are holy. You can be holy. To be holy is to be sanctified, which is to be set apart, literally. To be set apart from all the filth and the trash. That does not mean you isolate yourself, but that does mean that you are not consumed with the filth. Look at verse 7. It says, show a pattern of good works. That is very, very clear, isn't it? The NIV says, set them an example by doing what is good. Sir, you are to be the example for others to follow. Are you? And you are either way. That's the scary part about it. You can be the worst example in the world. Your kids are going to follow that. This man sacrifices his desires for what's best for his family. He does what's best. You know, it's not about always being right, is it? If you've been married at least 10 years or more, you know that. It's not about it's about being righteous. Proverbs 14:11 says, the house of the wicked will be overthrown, but the tent of the upright will flourish. The wicked will be overthrown, the righteous will flourish. Living a holy life. He lives righteously. Proverbs 14:34 says, the righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Man, we need to hear that today. Look at our nation. Look at what happened in the 9th District Court out in California. Overturning law. They already took they already passed that proposition that said marriage is between a man and a woman. And a rogue court decides to flip that around and to legalize homosexual, same-sex marriage. Just breaking precedent for hundreds of years to do what they want to do, to force that, to force their liberal agenda on our country. That's the nation we're living in, folks. Now, we can either engage that and be active and get involved in the process, or we can just turn a blind eye and hope everything goes away and maybe pray that some presidential election will fix it. It's not going to fix it. The Christians, the church, I believe is responsible for this. I believe it's our fault that this is happening, not theirs. We're the ones who are supposed to stand up for righteousness. And you could ask the person down the pew, and we could all ask each other, what did you do this week to stand up for righteousness? What did you do to combat this? Folks, we need holy. We are the ones who are called to be holy. And they laugh, and they are so entertained when they see us fail, when they see us fall, when they see us just get right involved in it. It's a high standard, isn't it? It goes on to say in verse 7, in doctrine showing integrity, reverence, and incorruptibility. Number 6, a godly man is discerning. He's discerning. He believes correctly. In your teaching, show integrity. That's purity of motive. That's your character. That's who you are when nobody else is watching. In your teaching, show reverence. That's seriousness concerning the things of God. We've already talked about that. Incorruptibility. Doing what is right over the long haul. This man has discernment. And it's so sad to see. I see young men with young babies all the time that clearly have no discernment. And it scares me to death. They should have to get a license before they can start having babies, but they don't have to get a license. Man, they just pop them out. And they have no discernment. And that poor little child's going to be just as foolish as his daddy unless someone breaks the chain. Discernment. It's possible. Open up the book of Proverbs. I'm reading a proverb every day this month. Some of you do that ritually. That's what you do. Do that. Gain in wisdom. Do you remember who your favorite teacher was back in school? I have many favorite teachers because I went to a lot of different schools. But I can remember each one. I love them. Dad, your job is to be a teacher. Your job is to disciple and to discipline. And it can't be one or the other, and really the two go hand in hand. Some men are really good at discipline. Boy, they're just, you know, they're real stern, but they're not discipling anybody. Others are terrible at both. I mean, we need to make a commitment here. I will disciple and I will discipline my kids, because if I don't, nobody else is going to do it. It's not somebody else's job to disciple and to discipline your kids. It's your job. Vodi Bakum is a name you may not be familiar with. He's a minister. He's kind of moving up in the world, in the Christian world. He's getting kind of a bigger name. And he has a very interesting church that he attends. They do things very differently. But the motto for his church, and I don't remember the name of his church, but the motto for his church is this: where dads disciple their families. That's the motto for Vodi Bakum's church. And I've heard him talk all about it. And the idea is men have relinquished their responsibility to either a Sunday school teacher or a school teacher or to some other person, an Awana leader. These are good things, by the way. Those are all three good things, right? But for a man to relinquish his opportunity, his responsibility, excuse me, to take advantage of the opportunity to disciple his own kids, what a shame. And it's happening all over. And it needs to stop. And we need to be thoughtful about it today. Are you discipling your family? If you're not, you need to make a decision today. And you need to show some humility. You need to show some follow through and get with it. It's your job to disciple your family, sir. Are you doing it? If not, do something about it today. And you need discernment to do that. Godliness is better caught than taught. Christianity is better caught than taught. And all this, you know, do as I say, not as I do, man, you need to throw that out with the garbage. That doesn't hold up to a middle schooler, much less to a thinking person who's going to grow up and say, no, I'm going to do as you do, Dad. So what are you doing? What kind of example are you setting? Are you showing discernment? Or are you just casually, foolishly, flip-flopping through life, hoping that everything turns out? I can assure you, everything will not turn out the way you want it to. Unless you show some discernment. Believe correctly and pass those beliefs on. Where did you get your moral beliefs? I can tell you where I got my belief on morals and religion and politics and worldview. And my dad. I got it from my dad. I think almost exactly how he thinks. Number 7, and lastly, the godly man is uplifting. He is uplifting. He speaks wisely. He speaks blessing into the life of his family. Look at verse 8. Sound speech that cannot be condemned. You see that? This is the use of healthy and wholesome language. Speech that builds up, even in ordinary conversation. Nobody can turn around and accuse this man of profanity or crudeness or crassness. It's not going to happen in his conversation. He's like E.F. Hutton. When he speaks, everybody listens because they know he has something uplifting to say. He is a builder. He is edifying his family. You see, a godly dad builds up his family with his words, never tears them down. You know, my father modeled this for me. My dad was the biggest Pat Fiordalise supporter, still is. I love my dad. I don't think he knows what he's talking about in this area, but boy, man, when I wanted to play the guitar, man, he thought I was going to be the next Willie Nelson. I don't know, Van Halen, whoever. Les Paul, I remember that. Man, he believed in me. He paid for those lessons even though they didn't have money to do it. And he supported me, and he drove me back and forth for years. When I picked up a basketball and dribbled that thing nonstop 4 or 5 hours a day for about 5 years of my life, my dad was right there behind me. You can do it, son. I believe in you. You're gonna be the best basketball player to ever live. He believed that. I knew it wasn't true, but I knew he believed it. He inspired me. He made me better. He built me up. Some people, if they told their dad, "Dad, I'm going into the ministry," their dad would be like, "Huh? Are you kidding? Oh, not my dad. You can do it, son. You're going to be great. I believe in you." He built me up. He never, and I can't remember a harsh word he ever said to me or has ever said to me. And I thank God for an uplifting father who chose his words correctly. Doesn't mean he was perfect. Doesn't mean he didn't stub his toe once in a while. And then there was that incident in the grocery store when I ran into the back of his heels with the grocery cart. That didn't go well. But he never said a harsh word to me about it. The New Living Translation translates verse 8 this way: "Let your teaching be so correct that it cannot be criticized. Then those who want to argue will be ashamed because they won't have anything bad to say about us." Man, wouldn't that be great if we were living lives that way? "Sir, your tongue can be a weapon to destroy, or it can be a tool to build up." Now, which is it? What was it this week? Was it a weapon to put down and to hurt, or was it a tool to build up? My son, my sons, and my daughter, we pray every night, and sometimes David gets a little wild and willy, so we put him to bed. But we have a little Bible called the Little Boy Bible, and we have a little girl Bible, and they fight over which one to read. It's always a very spiritual experience when they're fighting over which Bible we're going to read. But when we finally nail it down to one, and this little boy Bible's old and beat up and ripped apart, because that's what happens in my house to things, and that's probably not very reverent, but it is. And we read it every night, and we've done it so much that they know what stories are coming. They know a lot about the Bible. I'm very impressed with their Bible knowledge. Our Sunday school teachers are doing good work. But at the very end of that little devotional, we'll read a scripture, and at the very end of it is a little section in the little girl Bible. It says, "Becoming a woman of God." And we all say that out loud together. And in the little boy Bible, it says, "Becoming a man of God." And we read it, "Becoming a man of God," every night. You see, I want for my son to become a man of God, much more so than what his daddy is. And I want my little baby boy to grow up in an environment where his older brother is in the process of becoming a man of God, where he will want to be like his big brother, who wants to be like his daddy, who wanted to be like his daddy, to become a man of God. And I want for my daughter to marry a man of God. And I'm not willing to sit back and hope it all turns out that way. I'm going to get proactive. Ultimately, it's going to be their choice, isn't it? But I'm going to do what I can do, and I'm going to accept my responsibility. And I'm asking you, grandfather, dad, soon to be someday dad, ladies, do your part. Take your responsibility. And young ladies, these 7 important qualities should be exactly what you're looking for. Not, "Oh, he has a cute smile. Oh, his hair is just so cute." I had a lady tell me today that she thought I was pretty. That's the first time someone told me that in a long time. Because she liked my shirt. That felt kind of weird. But I got to tell you, if you're looking for that in a husband, you're looking for the wrong thing. You're gonna really fail. Don't waste 1 minute, single ladies. There's single again people all over. Don't waste 1 minute on a dud that doesn't qualify in these 7 categories, that don't meet these qualifications. If you do so, if you marry that dud, you'll do so at your own peril. And you'll regret it the rest of your life. And there's people around here that could tell you all about it, because they did. I'm not going to point anybody out, but they can tell you all about it. You see, marriage is like salvation. It's a life sentence, right? When you get saved, it's forever. And when you get married, it's for life. You don't just trade in and out. It's permanent. And what we need now, more than anything else, is for godly men. Because I see a lot of godly young ladies coming up, and I wonder, boy, who are they going to find? Because sometimes it's hard to find that young man that meets these qualifications. Wait, be patient. And young man, you might as well just forget going out on any dates until you get with it here, because they're not going to give you the time of the day until you do. You know, flying back, I'll close with this. Flying back on Thursday afternoon, we took time Thursday morning to go look at the city and had a great time walking around, look at the River Walk or whatever it's called. And then we realized we were late, and then I missed the airport. So it all got real stressful after that. And crazy airport. I don't know if there was a sign to find it or if I missed it. I ended up going to back road. They were like fueling planes and stuff. I knew I was in the wrong area. We finally got to where we needed to get. got on the plane. And by the way, all four planes were delayed and all that, so you're all used to that, I'm sure. But we got on the very last plane to fly from Cleveland into Richmond, and we were making our descent. And I was somewhere between praying and sleeping. Anybody can relate to that? I was doing a little napping, but I kind of prayed a little bit too. But I started praying for Kingsland. You know, all these thousands of people at the Southern Baptist Convention, all these huge churches and all this stuff that's going on. It's so exciting. But what does that mean here? What does that do for us? And I thought, man, what is God going to do? And I prayed for Kingsland, that we would grow this summer when every other church really declines during the summer. I prayed for Kingsland that we would increase in giving when pretty much the normal thing in summertime is for churches to decrease. For more people to come to Christ. For more things to happen. And I prayed about these things. But I was praying about my message too, because I was thinking about my points and blah, blah, blah. And then I stopped as we were making our descent, and I looked out the window. And this is the honest truth, Elizabeth can tell you. Looked out the window, and I saw the James River, and then I saw that little tower that's just west of our church. And I recognized that, and I knew just to look right, and there it was. There was Kingsland. I could see our church. I don't know how high. It was smaller than that from where I was looking. Just a little. I mean, we could be a 10,000-member church. When you're way up in the air, little. But I could see most of Chesterfield County from that vantage point, and I thought, oh, God, how huge our challenge is to reach Chesterfield County with the gospel. How's it going to happen? How is our little church going to reach Chesterfield County with the gospel? We've got a radio program, a television program, an internet program. We've got all programs out the ears. They're everywhere. But it's not going to reach Chesterfield County. I believe if our men will take the lead and make it personal, we can reach Chesterfield County. We could do something extraordinary, but it can't be my words. It can't be a thought. It can't be a purpose statement or a vision statement. It has to be real-life people who love Jesus, who love their wife, love their kids so much, and they love their kids' friends, and they love their wife's friends, and they love their neighbors, and they're concerned about their eternal state, and they do something about it. And I prayed that God would use this church to equip godly men to lead out in this region. So here's the time for evaluation as we come to a close. How are you doing? We should all evaluate ourselves here in this passage. Are you sensible or are you careless? Are you reverent or are you very casual about the things of God with your tongue? Are you temperate or are you driven by your desires? You just do whatever you feel like doing. Are you sound or are you undependable? Are you holy or are you worldly? Are you discerning or are you foolish? Are you uplifting or are you condemning? Will you commit, gentlemen? Will you commit to exhibiting these seven qualities in your life, knowing that you could never do it on your own, knowing that you need to ask for the Lord's help? Ladies, how can you encourage these qualities in your husband? You should think about that. Wednesday night at the Bible study, when the ladies meet, y'all can talk about that. What is God leading you to do about with what you've heard today? Would you pray with me? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? As we come to a close, we're going to sing some songs, and we're going home. You can enjoy your family all day long. I'm convinced that there is nothing in this world that could ever bring fulfillment like being a good dad. I doubt there's a man in this room that would disagree with me. I doubt that there's a lady in this room that would say otherwise. Being a good mom brings more fulfillment than anything else. You know, when it comes to being holy, there is a first step that has to take place. And it's not by making some type of New Year's resolution. It's not by going to some support group. Holiness can only come by being made holy. The Lord said, "Be holy as I am holy." But he knew that we were unholy, and he provided a way for us to become holy, and that was through the blood of his precious son, Jesus Christ. You can't be holy until you've been, as we sang this morning, washed in the blood of the Lamb. Have you been? Have you been born again? Have you been saved? You want to give your heart to Jesus today? You need to repent of your sin. That means you need to turn around. You need to ask his forgiveness. No different than if you had sinned against me or sinned against your neighbor. You need to go and apologize, right? You need to go make it right. Well, you need to do that with God. And really, the Bible, David said in the Psalms, against you, you only have I sinned and done this wickedness in your sight. So really, every sin you've ever done, thinking it was to another person or it was against God. It was an offense to God. And there is no salvation. There is no being saved. There is no being rescued unless you're willing to admit you are lost. You can't be forgiven of sin that you're not willing to admit you have in your life, that you've committed. You need to repent. You need to understand that sin condemns you. There is a real heaven and a real hell. And the only escape from that judgment for our sin is the blood of Jesus applied to your life. If you're willing to give your heart to Jesus today, invite Christ into your life, ask Him to forgive you of your sins, make Him your Lord and Savior, you can pray where you are. You can come forward. I'll pray with you. It's a decision. It's an act of the will. And God gave you a free will. Is He drawing you to Himself today? Why don't you just surrender to Him right now? Give your heart to Jesus. If you want someone to pray with you, our time of invitation will be a time that you can do that, or to come and request membership in our church. If you've given your heart to Jesus and you need to request baptism, if you have something you want to pray about, come forward during our invitation. Pray by yourself at the altar if you'd like. Don't let this opportunity come and go. Do business with God today. I know it's late, and I'm sure you're hungry. Oh, don't be distracted, and don't let anybody cause distractions during this moment. During our invitation today, all that notwithstanding, Dad, you are not quite where you want to be. It could be in one of these seven categories. It could be in a category where the Holy Spirit has just pricked your heart today. Why don't you lead by example? Why don't you do something about it? And there's a variety of things. It might become a phone call, a letter, a conversation with your family, an apology to your family. Family, I've not been doing what I ought to be doing, and I'm going to change. I'm giving it to the Lord. You may want to come and take advantage of the altar today, Dad, and be an example in that respect. Spend some time with the Lord. We won't rush. We want you to have time to do what God's leading you to do. Please take advantage of our invitation, of the Holy Spirit's invitation at this time. Lord God, I pray that you would work in our lives. I pray that you would heal those who are sick. I pray that you would encourage those who are discouraged. And most of all, Lord, for us that are just really battling right now, where your Holy Spirit is working in the hearts of men and women, Lord, I pray that, that our folks would just raise up the white flag of surrender and say, Lord, I surrender all. Lord, we know that you'll take us just like we are. Thank you so much for loving each and every one of us just like we are. And Lord, I pray that you would move in this time of invitation, that each one of us would take full possession of that unconditional love that you've offered. And that you would intervene, especially with our fathers, especially with our men who are struggling with a variety of things and don't want anybody to know about it. Lord, I pray that you would intervene in that person's life today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with me and sing, Come As God Leads You, team, to come up in front of you. If the whole mission team would just come before so everybody can see them, how beautiful they are. And we're going to pray for them right now. Next week, they will be gone. So you need to invite some friends to church next week. We've got a lot of people going on this trip. But we'll be here next Sunday morning, 11 o'clock. Don't forget about it. And invite your friends and neighbors. But these folks are going to Cleveland, Tennessee. And Elizabeth and I are driving down with our family after church next week to meet up with them in Cleveland, Tennessee for their mission trip. Now, you see all their faces, but I want to read their names because some of them I think are out of town and stuff. But you need to pray for these people. And I hope you got your prayer card at the pancake breakfast and left a generous donation, which evidently a lot of people did because we had like $900-something come in from our pancake breakfast last week. So good job on that. Ashton Brock, Jeannie Brock, Beth Buckwalter, Anna Buckwalter, Aaron Buckwalter, Cindy Dance, Steve Dance, Jim and Jan Davis, Ed Faggart, Mary Faggart, Pat Fiordalise, pray for him, Beverly Pierce, William Pierce, Barbara Shannon, Kevin, Jenny, Sarah, and Will Snead are going on this mission trip. And please pray for them. Folks, we're going to have a one-day revival on June 29th right here. We're going to have a revival, a longer revival than that at the end of the summer. I'm praying for God to move. Will you pray for that? He's not going to do anything if we don't pray. He's under no obligation to just show up. We need to pray. These good folks, a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of energy going on this mission trip. They deserve our prayer. And God will respond to our prayer. That's how it works in kingdom terms. It takes a lot of money, takes a lot of sacrifice, takes a lot of time, but more than anything else, it takes a lot of prayer. So would you pray for a little mini revival to break out in Cleveland, Tennessee, as God uses these folks? They'll leave this coming weekend, be gone all week down there. Would you join me in praying for them right now? Lord God, I just thank you for our team. I thank you for Beverly Pierce and the great job she's doing with our mission committee, and for this team of people who have sacrificed vacation time and money, a lot of energy, to go down and be your missionaries to a depressed part of Tennessee. People down there that will be very, very appreciative of our coming. Lord, I pray that you would use us in that boys' club. I pray that you'd protect us out on those roofs and houses and the projects that we'll be doing. Lord, I pray that you would shine your favor down on us as we invite people to come to another block party and preach your word. And Lord, I pray that a bunch of people will get saved through this. Lord, I pray that you would use each and every one of us, young and old, man and woman, for your glory on this trip. I pray that our people would be very careful to pray for us while we're gone. And Lord, I pray that you'd bring a revival to Kingsland Baptist Church. I pray that it would be something that would be so powerful and so life-changing that we could take it out of here and take it all over America, all over the world. Lord, help us to think big. We thank you for giving us this one mission trip, but Lord, we look forward to the day when we're having multiple mission trips all over the planet, on each continent. Lord, we want to dream big, big dreams for your glory because we know you're a great God and you'll do great things as we do it. So we trust this group in your hands and we bless them and we thank you for your blessing on them. And we pray that you would take them there, bring them home safely. May this be a life-changing experience for each one involved. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Before we dismiss, before y'all can disperse, I'm not sure where you're supposed to go, but before we leave, want to acknowledge a wonderful young couple that has come and joining membership in our church family today. And I did my internship in 1995 at a little Southern Baptist church in Georgia and made a lifelong friend by the name of Bill Gowder. Bill's a mentor of mine. He's a wonderful, wonderful preacher. And he's a assistant pastor of a big old church in Knoxville, Tennessee, called West Park Baptist Church. Really good church. And two very important members of his church had to move from Knoxville to come up to Richmond to take over the Chick-fil-A at Willow Lawn, at the shops at Willow Lawn. And that's Jonathan and Ashley Lighty. And I got to know them through my ministry friend, Bill. But they've been driving a good distance to be here. They drive about 30 minutes to be at our church. But they've grown to love our church. They love their Sunday school class. Their Bible study is a new Bible study for young married, and so they've plugged into that the last few weeks, and they've looked at us, they've evaluated us, and they've decided to join ranks with us today, and so we're very happy about that. After we dismiss in prayer, I'm going to ask Jonathan and Ashley to stand up there, Elizabeth stand with them, and you can come up and shake their hand. You can even hug them if you want to. I don't think they'd have a problem with that. But they'll be happy to get to know you. And anybody that wants to be part of this family, man, we want you to come. Get saved. Get baptized by immersion, which they both have. And, of course, we have our new members class. Alan Chu is running. We have one right now. We have one ongoing. And that's every Sunday morning at 9:30 if you want to get acquainted with our church, over in the Family Life Center, the gymnasium across the street. And you can learn all about Kingsland, and you too can go through the process of becoming a member of our church. And we're so glad that you guys are entering that process today, and very, very thankful.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordalise, and I'm the pastor of Kingsland Baptist Church. I want to thank you for watching Connecting at Kingsland with us tonight. We entitled our television program Connecting at Kingsland because it is our desire to connect people with Christ all over our community and all over the world. You can look us up on the internet at www.kingslandbaptist.com from anywhere, anytime you'd like. And we'd love to know if you've been watching, if you would like to write in, if you have a prayer request or anything like that, at 8801 Perrymont Road, Richmond, Virginia, 23237. If you have a need or something we can pray with you about, write us or call us at 275-1285. And I want to encourage you to come personally and connect with us for a worship service any Sunday morning at 11 a.m. We also have small group Bible studies for all ages every Sunday morning at 9:30. And wonderful, wonderful children's programs, youth programs on Sundays, and on Wednesday nights at 6:30. We have Awana and Youth Club and all kinds of things for your children. So come see us. And if you have a prayer request or just need to contact us, we would love to hear from you and pray for you. If you have a spiritual need or questions, you can contact us, and we will help you. You know, God loves you, and Jesus, God's Son, died for you and for the sins of the world, and wants a relationship with you. Tonight very well may be the night that you need to connect with Christ. You know, the Bible says that if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Goes on to say in Romans 10:13, for whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I hope that tonight you will make that decision to give your heart to Christ, to ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and to forgive you of your sins, to repent of those sins, and to make him your Lord and your Savior. If you do make that decision for Christ, please call us here at the church, 275-1285, and let us know about it. And come see us so we can pray for you and pray with you and help you grow in your relationship with the Lord. Again, I want to thank you for connecting with us tonight at Kingsland. We hope to see you again real soon.
Love is here. Love is now. Love is pouring from His hands, from His brow. Love is near. Love is here.